Distinguished guests, my dear colleague, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you. On behalf of KL Training Institute Noida, I, Nigmanand Mishra, DGM Training, extend a sincere and warm welcome to today's speaker, Sri Akhilesh Magal, Head Renewable Energy Advisory Board, Gujarat Energy Research and Management Institute, Jarmi. Seniors and friends from different work center of GAIL connected virtually. Ladies and gentlemen, with me, Dr. R.S. Velumurugan, GM Training, is present here at GTI, along with Sri P.C. Gupta, Chief Manager from TQM Department. Petroleum Conservation and Research Association, under the guidance of Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, in association with oil and gas PSUs, has been at the forefront of promoting energy conservation in various sectors. PCRA has been organizing a nationwide campaign aimed at making the country aware about the conservation of oil and gas every year. This year also, Sakhyam 2021, and a number of programs related to conservation of petroleum products were organized throughout the country. Sakhyam 2021 was inaugurated in 16th January 2021 at Delhi. GAIL is also taking part in this month-long celebration by organizing number of events to sensitize people across the country on conservation of oil and gas. GAIL Training Institute Noida, in association with Total Quality Management Department, organizing a series of panel discussion or talk show related to the theme Sakhyam 2021 Green and Clean Energy by eminent speaker from different domain. Earlier, GAIL Training Institute successfully conducted two different talk show on subject improved domestic cooking burner and PNG and waste plastic for energy conservation in association with Indian Institute of Petroleum, Dehradun. And also we have conducted two panel discussion on electric vehicle by IIT Madras and the role of city gas distribution in clean and green energy by eminent speaker from oil and gas domain. In today's talk show, we are having a speaker from Germany who is going to deliver on subject role of renewable energy in India's electricity sector. Now, I will request Dr. R.S. Velumurugan ji to introduce the faculty and brief on the today's topic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Ji. Welcome and warm good morning to Mr. Akhilesh Magal, Head Renewable Advisory, Gujarat Energy Research and Management Institute, JERMI. Colleagues across GAIL watching today's webcast, ladies and gentlemen, viewing the recorded sessions of the talk show on the role of renewable energy in India's electricity sector. First, let me introduce today's speaker. Mr. Akhilesh Magal heads the renewable advisory team at JERMI, where he leads the advisory and consulting group. The group's main task is to act as a think tank and technical backstopper to the government of Gujarat Energy and Petrochemical Department. He has been instrumental in drafting the solar policy, solar wind hybrid policy, and the electric vehicle policy for the state of Gujarat. He holds a master's degree in environmental engineering from Carnegie Mellon University, Pittsburgh, USA. Before hand over the session to the speaker, let me brief on the topic. As we portray the bigger picture of energy economy for the country and formulate strategy aspects of the country, it is highly desirable to see the growth prospects of other upcoming technologies and how the global business dynamics is changing, especially with reference to fossil fuel and more specific to natural gas. As on one side, we have ambitious plans to grow the natural gas basket of India from 6% to 15%. So therefore, we need to see the other viable energy options, keeping in mind the upper cap of pollution levels also, with which we can withstand without damage to the environment and health. This leads to various other options like renewable energy, options like solar, wind energy, electric vehicles and battery technologies, etc. Having a business diversification strategy in such upcoming and growing areas, it can be strategized that how business organization can use domain expertise of upcoming and emerging technologies as strategic enabler to transform their operation paradigm. Therefore, today's topic on renewable energy is much relevant to today's business environment and also the tagline of Saksham 2021. Today's talk show will cover the major topics broadly, why the renewable energy is an important pathway towards decarbonization and India's Paris commitments, current policies and support programs, current installed capacities and projections, challenges and opportunities in the domain. With this background, I hand over the session to Mr. Akhilesh. Please, you can start.
Thank you, sir. Good morning. I hope I'm audible and also my screen is visible to all the members.
Yes. Yes, you can proceed.
Thank you for the very kind introduction, sir, and also thank you for having me here to give a presentation today in Saksham. It's a great honor and indeed a great pleasure for me. Before we head into the presentation, I think a quick background of what JERMI does, Gujarat Energy Research and Management Institute. It was set up by Sri Narendra Modi, who is now the Prime Minister, who was back then the Chief Minister of Gujarat. This was set up in as a part of the Vibrant Gujarat Summit way back in 2001-2002, just when he had become the Chief Minister. Since about 2008, we are now incorporated as under the Energy and Petrochemical Department as a center of excellence, as a research institute, as a training institute. Our main focus really is to focus on all energy aspects, both conventional and non-conventional energy. In the conventional side, we are working on oil and gas, mainly on exploration side, on data analytics, and geology and geophysics. On the renewable side, which I head, what we really do is we serve the Energy and Petrochemical Department and also to some extent the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy in New Delhi to mainly calibrate, to make policies, regulations around the renewable energy sector and to really understand how we can promote this sector in a bigger way in India. Having said that, I would like to start my presentation with your permission. The presentation really has five broad points these are the points on your screen. We'll really look very quickly at what is renewable energy. All of you are in the energy sector, and so this may seem very childish. Why should we really go back to the books? But I think a lot of us have some basic misunderstanding of what renewable energy is. So we'll try and understand what renewable energy is and how it contrasts to the conventional energy sources that we have. Second, I think very important point is to understand why do we even need renewable energy? That's a very important question to answer. Most of us perhaps know it. We've heard about climate change, global warming, and so on. But we'll look into some of these matters in greater detail. A critical point whenever we discuss renewable energy is the Paris Agreement. This is under the UNFCCC, the United Nations Framework for Climate Change. And India being one of the signatories to the Paris Agreement, we have certain commitments. Now, what are those commitments? How will we keep up those commitments is something we will also explore. We'll also look very broadly at India's power sector. How does our power sector look like? What are the composition of various energy sources, coal, gas, and so on? And where does renewable energy play an important part in this sector? We'll also look very briefly at policies and pathways. Of course, there are several policies that we could discuss given the paucity of time and the setting here. We will focus on some of the policies and look at what are the drivers for the proliferation or the success of renewable energy. So let's begin. I think a very simple yet childish slide it may appear, but I think very important, as I said. So basically, we understand the basic classification between renewable energy and non-renewable energy. And we all know, if somebody asks even a sixth standard or seventh standard child, he'll say, okay, coal, oil, nuclear, even gas, for instance, these come under non-renewable energy sources. Renewable energy sources are, of course, solar, wind, and biomass. This is very simple and very clear to understand. But what is not perhaps adequately understood is the definition. If you see on the right side of your screen, non-renewable energy is defined as energy sources that cannot be replaced, and I have highlighted it in red, in human lifetime. And in contrast, renewable energy are those sources, energy sources that can be replenished in human lifetime. So the argument really is coal, oil, and all this can actually be depleted in our lifetime, whereas solar, wind, and etc., and biomass may not be depleted in our human lifetime. The definition is very, 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 it's a very thin line between these two things. I'll tell you why. Let's look, for instance, the very, existence of our mainstream energy source, coal. Coal and oil are actually naturally found energy sources. It's not man-made. Yes, oil is processed, but in a sense, coal was formed due to natural geological processes over time. So if you give adequate amount of time and pressure to hydrocarbons, then certainly coal will be formed, right? But it cannot be formed in human lifetime, right? It takes very, very long in order to do that. The difference is between solar. Solar is constant throughout, it's constant in the sense that you can predict what are the curves of solar or wind for a given month, for a given day, even for a year with fair accuracy. There is some amount of uncertainty, but fairly you can predict it. So it's really an issue of human lifetime. Does it get depleted in our lifetime or not? If you look at the sun, we all know the sun as a source of energy will deplete after billions of years, but it's not relevant to human lifetimes. So the key here is, does this source of energy deplete in human lifetime? Now, one last point before we go to the next slide. Let's look at biomass. Is biomass truly a renewable energy? This can be really debated. Because if you see biomass, it really depends upon the rate of growth and rate of extraction. If my rate of extraction of the biomass essentially means wood and so on, if the rate of extraction is greater than the rate of production, then it's not truly renewable. It will get over in our human lifetime. But if the rate of production equals rate of extraction, then it becomes renewable. So it's a very fine definition, and we should be very, very careful when we deal with this. And I want all of the people listening here to bear this in mind. Next, why renewable energy? Why should we even look at renewable energy? India is, of course, having one of the world's largest sources of coal reserves. Our oil exploration has been significantly improved, and we have, as Sir was mentioning, we want to augment a significant portion, 15-16% of our thing with gas. So why do we really need to move towards renewable energy? I think the key point to be understood, and that's highlighted in the first box, I think most of us know what climate change is, fact that the earth is warming up, and the average temperatures in the earth is going to go up greater than 4 degrees if we do nothing, as on today. So climate change is a very, very important, an important threat. And India is one of the most sensitive countries to climate change. Our economy depends on agriculture even today. We have a large number of farmers who are still dependent on rain-fed agriculture. And so the presence of rains in a timely fashion, etc., is significantly sensitive to climate change, the impacts of climate change. So it's very important that we know that the burning of fossil fuels is directly correlated with climate change. And so we need an alternate form of energy sources, and that's why renewable energy is going to play a very, very critical role. Point number two, energy security. Again, those in the energy sector would really understand the concept of energy security maybe came into birth in the 70s after the oil crisis and the Kuwait war. That's when the first forays into looking at renewable energy, especially solar and wind, started, a lot of research and a lot of development started happening in the US and indeed across other countries in the world. India also recognized the importance of energy security, mainly from the fact that we do not have adequate resources, especially in oil, not in coal. And so the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, which was then called MNES in the 90s, was set up for non-conventional energy sources. It was known as non-convention, today it's known as renewable, to really look at how we can become independent and to, let's say, fulfill our father of our nation, Gandhiji's dream of being Swaraj, even in terms of energy. So renewable energy plays a very important role in furthering the energy security of this country and to prevent price shocks and other geopolitical conflicts, especially with the Middle East. We've seen how this pans out. Every time there's a conflict, there's a war, the price of especially the crude oil goes up, and you and I, consumers, have to bear the price. So energy security is an important aspect. The third, I think, equally important aspect is resource conservation. How can we actually conserve and become more efficient in coal and oil resources? It's not that we completely ban the mining of coal or the extraction of oil. This is needed as our economy is developing, as more and more people are coming out of poverty. This is extremely important that we certainly extract resources, but how can we do this in a much more efficient way, in a way that can minimize these natural resources, at the same time not compromise on the needs of the people. This is a very fine balance, and this is something that renewable energy can certainly augment, if not totally replace. Point number four is environmental protection. We all know the ill effects of coal mining. I mean, it can really destroy forests. There are tribal issues, rights, various other social conflicts that can come up. Also, the burning of coal in power plants it leads to air pollution. Particulate matter is one of the 2.5 is even PM10 is one of the leading cause for health diseases, especially asthma, bronchitis, and all of that. We know this being in Delhi, how bad this is, especially in the winter months. So can we actually look at shifting energy production, electricity production, I must say, to much more cleaner and greener sources of energy, which is where renewable energy plays a very important role. The final point, I think, for most business-driven people and for the DISCOMs is cost saving. Renewable energy is already cheaper. So both solar and wind is already cheaper on a per unit basis than coal for the first time in the country. This happened about 2 years ago. And since then, we've seen that the prices for solar and wind are indeed going down even rapidly. And we'll come to this in my further slides. So we looked at why renewable energy was so important. And we also saw that climate change is one of the most important drivers. So India is a signatory of the Paris Agreement. The Paris Agreement, you can see below in the slide, was signed by 189 countries. Nearly all countries across the world have signed the Paris Agreement in December 2015. So it's been 5 years since the agreement was signed, and it was a landmark agreement because until then, all the countries had not come together to commit that we will fight climate change and we will take specific action in order to combat climate change. The agreement is very, very simple in very broad terms, but when you go into details, it can be complicated. The intention is to limit global temperature rise to between 2 degrees to 1.5 degrees. At least 2 degrees, best case scenario, 1.5 degrees. Currently, if we do nothing, we will see a global temperature rise of about 4 degrees by the middle of this century, which is totally harmful for our environment and indeed for human life. So what are India's targets under the Paris Agreement? This is indicated in the table above. You'll see that there are two kinds of targets. One is an unconditional target and the other is a conditional target. So India, being a poorer country, had the following argument. They said that, listen, America, Europe, Japan, all these other countries which have already developed, they have done on the basis of fossil fuels. So you guys have developed and you have made your comfort of, standard of living very high. People are out of poverty, more or less. And now you're telling us when we want to develop, don't use fossil fuels. This is not fair. So, a lot of people in UNFCCC agreed to this and said, all right, so tell us what kind of conditions do you need in order for you to meet these targets? So India said, listen, for the unconditional target, this is something we will do without any conditions. We will reduce our emission intensity of GDP, which means the amount of emission per dollar of GDP or per rupee of GDP, right, which is a mark of efficiency. How efficiently are we able to grow our economy without carbonizing it? So how can we decarbonize our economy? So India says about 33 to 35%, so one third of from 2005 levels, we will be able to reduce our emissions. This is unconditional. We'll do this without any help, without any requirement. But we have a conditional target. We will increase the cumulative power generation in gigawatt terms, installed capacity terms, to 40% of by 2030. But we have a condition. What is the condition? That the transfer of technology and low-cost finance to India must come through. You must give us the latest wind turbines. You must give us the latest battery storage technologies. You must give us the high-efficiency solar panels. You must give us better grid management. All this technology should come to India without any IP and paying very, very high prices. And low-cost finance at around 1 or 2% of finance, if it can be facilitated by the European Union, by America, then this is something that we will need. So India, being one of the signatories to the Paris Agreement, has to do it. We have to meet these targets. It is our obligation, and in the we will stand losing our face in the international arena. So this is something that we have to do. Let's look at, when we talk about emissions, where are the emissions coming from? So we have two pie charts. I'd like to start with the one on the top left. The top left shows the sector-wise emissions in India, and the bottom right shows the energy sector emissions. So let's look at the sector-wise emissions. So the pie chart is fairly clear. 74%, and I've highlighted it in the blue blue circle. 74% of our emissions in India, right, is coming from the energy sector. That's three-fourths, and that is significant. So any efforts that we do should go into decarbonizing the energy sector. The other sectors are agriculture and forestry, mainly the loss of biodiversity due to the proliferation of agriculture, fertilizers, and so on, pesticides and so on in agriculture. This all needs fossil fuels to manufacture it, and they give off emissions. Also included in agriculture is methane emissions from the cows and other livestock. Methane is very, very potent as a greenhouse gas. Its potential is significantly larger than CO2. So a lot of the bovine and other livestock emissions is also included. So 15% of India's emissions are coming from the agriculture sector. Waste burning and so on, methane emissions from landfills also contributes to about 4%, and industrial processes. So because of the manufacturing, crude oil refining, plastics, so on and so forth, 7% of the emissions from processes are also observed, are also documented. And nevertheless, what is very important to understand, the key takeaway here is 74%, that is three-fourths of our emissions is from the energy sector. If you open that, if you zoom that in and say, okay, from where, what are the main sources within the energy sector? Let's take a look at it. That is depicted in the bottom right side. So if you see 51% of that 74%, right, is coming from the electricity generation sector, 51%, right? So about 30-something percent overall in India comes from electricity generation sector. That is significant, right? So how do we actually decarbonize the electricity generation sector? Through solar, wind, biomass, hydro, all these technologies. I will not be discussing each of these technologies. That is really not the, it's not a technology presentation here today. But most of these technologies can be used, and we'll see which policies are encouraging which kind of technologies. But the key takeaway here is 51% of that energy sector emissions is coming really from the electricity generation, significant. Then comes the transport sector. 13% of the energy sector pie is coming from the transport sector, mainly from burning petrol, diesel, to some extent kerosene in aviation fuel. So this is also a significant contributor. The next is industry. 25% of emissions, energy sector emissions, are from industry. Now, what is this? What is this? You may ask me, what is this? This slice of the pie chart. Where is it coming from? So when we say industry energy emissions, this is the emissions associated with the production of energy in captive power plants. For example, steel, cement sectors, they have their own power plants and they need energy to power up their processes. They don't say depend on the grid. So all grid related energy comes from 51% on the right side. Industry portion is really the self-owned generation, captive what is known as. So that is also significant. So how can we replace this with renewable energy needs to be seen. It's a little more difficult because most industry processes are 24/7. Solar is not 24/7, it's only about 7 hours. And wind also is mainly in the night time. So there are certain mismatch between demand and supply. And that is what technologists like myself, policymakers, we have to work towards coming up with better technologies that can actually totally make industries independent. We are not there yet, but we hope in the next 10 years, we can actually go through it. The remaining is others, unaccounted and fugitive emissions, emissions that are through gas, for example, gas escaping into the atmosphere is fugitive. It is just escaped. So these form a very small, small contribution to the energy, the emissions from the energy sector. Key takeaways is energy forms very, very important, 74%. And out of this, electricity generation is very, very critical. So if we want to meet our Paris commitment, we have to begin by the electricity sector. And that's why the role of this, the title of this presentation, role of renewable energy in India's electricity sector is very, very important. So going to the next slide, let's look at what are India's renewable energy targets by 2022. So we're not very far away, right? We're there only next year, 1.5 years we have. So the pie chart shows you the government's priority area. And I'll take you through the pie chart. We'll start from the right side, the blue part. 34% is scheduled to come from wind. So overall, India wants to do 175 gigawatt. Giga is 10 raised to 9, as we know. So 175 gigawatt of installed power generation capacity will come from renewables. India's current installed base is around 350, 360 gigawatt. So 175% of that will come from renewable energy. That is fascinating. And out of that, 60 gigawatt, which is 34 to 35%, will come from wind. 60 gigawatt will come from solar PV, photovoltaic solar for electricity generation. And that forms about 34% again. And when I say utility means large solar power plants on solar parks installed on the ground, on the land, in farmlands, in wastelands. You might have heard of Charanka Solar Park in Gujarat. We are building another 3 or 4 solar parks. There's a Rewa solar park in Madhya Pradesh. Rajasthan has many solar parks, 2 or 3 solar parks. So this contributes about 60 gigawatt or 35% of that target. Then comes 40 gigawatts of rooftop solar PV. Same technology, but in a smaller scale installed on buildings, on metro stations, on malls, on factories, on schools, and our homes. Even apartment complexes, you can install. These are smaller installations. So that is 40 gigawatts, significant. And we'll see how India is doing so far with regards to this target. 15 gigawatt comes from other renewable energy sources. That is bioenergy. If you look at biomass, that is converting wood and waste agricultural products, rice husks, coconut husks, all of these various things. Biomethanation, that is gas through biological processes, anaerobic digestion. All this forms about 15 gigawatt. SHP stands for small hydropower. These are run-of-the-river based hydropower, not the large dams. And then WTE means waste to energy. That is using the waste, municipal solid waste, and converting it into energy. So these are smaller. So if you look at the government's priority area, 60 plus 40, the one in yellow, gives you 100 gigawatt. So out of the 175 gigawatt target, 100 gigawatt is coming from solar and 60 is coming from wind. So it's very clear where the government's priorities are. We want to do solar because India is a renewable rich resource in solar. We have a great radiation throughout the country, especially in the western states like Gujarat, Rajasthan. And so that's where the government's priority is. Wind is far more location specific. Right. So if I go to Tamil Nadu, especially in the southern districts of Tuticorin and then Tirunelveli, Nagarkoil, these areas, you begin to see that the wind potential is very high. Same thing in few places on the Western Ghats in Karnataka and so on. But if you go to West Bengal, if you go to Orissa, if you go to Jharkhand, the the wind resource is not very good. So you'll spend the same amount of money installing a wind turbine, but then it will generate less amount of energy. So it's not a very attractive investment opportunity. And also from an engineering perspective, it is not the right place to install these wind turbines. And another important thing, wind turbines not very good in a small scale. Putting it on the rooftop, you can do it. There are some models, but they're not very efficient. And in a city like Delhi, for example, wind turbines really don't make they don't make sense at all, right? So it's a wasted investment. That's why, because solar can be installed from Leh Ladakh to Kanyakumari to West Bengal to the border near Pakistan, you have fairly good radiation and fairly good resource available. And so solar remains one of the mainstream renewable energy sources for India today, as we go forward, certainly, and well into the future. Let's come to the next slide. Very interesting. On the right side, we'll start with, and then we'll go to the left side. So India has upgraded its targets to 450 gigawatt of renewable energy by 2030. So by 2022, the previous slide, he had 175 gigawatt. Then Mr. Modi, our Honorable Prime Minister, went to the UNFCCC conference in last year in New York, in actually not last year, in 2019, I beg your pardon, September, and he made an announcement that we will do 450 gigawatt. And just think about this number, because India's current installed power capacity, all sources, coal, gas, you know, hydro, everything put together is only about 350, 360 gigawatt. So we'll do 450 of only renewables by 2030, in the next 9 or 10 years. And what's interesting is you can see the mistakes the media makes. And so we have to be very, very careful when we read such, even from very reputable, you know, publications online, you see that the date is wrong. They say it by 2022. It's actually 2030. There's no way we can do 2022. So be very careful while taking such sources of, you know, information. But what is important is Mr. Modi's statement, which is mentioned below. He says, we must accept that if we have to overcome a serious challenge like climate change, then what we are doing at the moment is just not enough. This is a very, very powerful statement from the head of a state, one of the largest countries in the world in terms of population. And no others, you know, very few people have made this kind of a statement. And if you see what America was doing in the last 4 years, they actually withdrew from the climate change agreement. And now Mr. Biden has come back. But India, for the last, indeed, the term of Mr. Modi, and even before that, has consistently said that we must act against climate change. We have been very clear about it. So this political will, continuity in political will, has been very, very important. Now, if you look at the breakup of this 450 gigawatt target, no surprises. Again, the yellow part of the pie chart tells you 300 gigawatt. Now, that's a mind-boggling number. 300 gigawatt, 67% of our renewable energy goals will come from solar PV. Right? This includes both rooftops as well as large solar farms, and also on farms, on various other scrub lands, dry lands, arid lands, so on. And 140 gigawatt will come from wind. So 60 gigawatt of wind from the previous slide, the blue, has been upgraded to 140 gigawatt, and 40 plus 60, 100 gigawatt of solar has been upgraded to 300 gigawatt. So we have tripled the target. Others, as we can see, bioenergy, small hydro, remain very, very small. You may ask me why. Why is it that we are not giving emphasis on bioenergy, on hydropower, and so on? The thing with hydropower is you can only put up installations where hydro is there, which is mainly Himalayas today. In the south, most hydro rivers have been tapped. So mainly in the northeast, in the Himalayas, etc. But in the plains of Uttar Pradesh, you can't really, for example, or even Madhya Pradesh, you can't really, the potential for hydropower is less. So it's highly location specific, and therefore the targets are also less. Then your question might be, what about bioenergy? Why can't we look at biogas, right? Especially in electricity generation, can we look at biogas seriously? The answer is yes, but it's limited. Why is it limited? Because the amount of access to bio waste today is limited. Today, if you go to any village in India, most of the the so-called agricultural waste is recycled very well. It is a perfectly closed loop cycle. It goes to feeding as, you know, it goes to fodder as for the animals, or it goes to other things, putting it back to the soil to enrich the carbon and the nitrogen content of the soil. In fact, even the cow dung is used as primary biomass in cooking in India even today. So a lot of these bio waste, so-called, is already used in various places in India. If you look at, for example, restaurant waste, you may think restaurant waste is all dumped, but the fact is, no, it goes into feeding animals. You know, pigs and so on are being fed through hotel waste and kitchen waste. Even cows are being fed. So in India, we have this closed loop. We are one of the highest in terms of recycling. So availability of biomass is very, very limited in India. And I think that's why the government recognizes it. In case of solar and wind, you have no input. There's no fuel. The sun is free and the wind is free. There's nothing to be paid. There's nobody to depend on. And as long as we can predict and the wind patterns and the solar patterns, we should be able to extract it to a very, very good extent. So India has put a very, very strong signal out in the world, in the global community, that we mean business. We want to really go very, very aggressive on renewable energy, especially solar and then wind. So you may say, very good, there are very good political announcements, but please, why don't you tell me what are our achievements? Are we on track, or is it just, you know, big talk? Let's look at it. Four graphs, four stacked bar graphs. The blue one is a target. This is a 175 gigawatt target by 2022, not the 450 gigawatt. If you look at the wind target, we had discussed it's a 60 gigawatt target. As on date, as per the official statistics from the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, we are at about 38 gigawatt. So we have just over 1 year, and we have to reach 60 gigawatt. So we're just greater than half, right? 60%. And that's a big question. Will we reach it? My answer is perhaps not, right? And we'll come to that. Why is that so? Then let's come to solar PV utility. So in the larger solar farm, out of the 60 gigawatt target, we have only reached about 34 gigawatt. So about just greater than half. Then we come to the rooftop sector. Very bad performance. Out of the 40 gigawatt target, we have only done 3 gigawatt. And then if you look at the others, bioenergy, small hydro, we have already met the target. So that is great news on that. But the big concern, I think, as we can see, is if you have to ask me as a researcher, will we meet the targets? The answer is most likely no. We will not have installed capacity in the next 1 year, 1.5 years that will meet the targets. So we are behind our targets. That is the negative part. But what is the positive part is, in 2010, so exactly 10 years ago, when the National Solar Mission was announced, India's solar capacity, I'll just look at solar. Solar capacity was hardly few tens of megawatts, less than a gigawatt. So in 10 years, from no gigawatts, from nearly no gigawatts, we have come to 34 gigawatts. For a poor country with low per capita income, this is a remarkable achievement, and it is recognized world over. And in fact, even the official IEA, the International Energy Agency, has commended India, saying we've done a great job. So the targets which we set ourselves are very, very ambitious, and we may not be able to meet it. But because these targets were there, we have really come a very long way in moving towards the target. So that is the positive side. Now let's look at the reasons. Let's look at rooftop solar PV, right? Why is it that our rooftop performance has been so poor? One of the main reasons is, unlike large solar farms where you can acquire some land, sign a power purchase agreement, set up a huge installation, rooftop is far more challenging. For any company who wants to set up the rooftop system, he has to go to each and every rooftop and go to them, consumer, and say, sir, this is rooftop, these are the benefits, go and install it, do a site survey. So it's a lot of work to install the same amount of capacity. Easier on the ground, but very difficult on rooftop. But there are certain advantages. Why would you want to do rooftop? One, it it will allow for people's participation in the climate change. Everybody will feel, yes, we have rooftop. 30-40% of my electricity I am meeting through solar energy, right? This is reducing my bills. This is a huge concern in Delhi, for example, where electricity prices are so high, especially in summers with AC. Even a small house, 2 or 3 ACs, you'll run into 15,000 to 20,000 rupee bills. So if you can even reduce 50% of that, then it starts making a lot of sense. So people feel that we're not only benefiting personally, but we're also contributing to a larger aim. So that is the advantage. The second advantage is you distribute the generation. Let's say there is a huge solar park and the transmission line is coming into the national grid and there's a problem with the transmission line. Huge capacity goes offline, right? Whereas if solar is distributed, the generation is distributed at the point of consumption, then you avoid such huge or these extreme cases where the grid goes offline, and you also distribute the generation in a much more uniform way. If there's a big cloud that comes on a solar park because of a cyclone or storm, then suddenly there's a dip in generation, right? Gigawatts will suddenly go down. But if you have a distributed across the country, even if some cyclone is there in one area, other areas will still be producing. So when we have a national grid, having distributed generation is really, really important and matters a lot. But the truth of the matter is we have not been doing well here. And that has to be recognized, has to be understood, that we have room to improve. Now, let's look at where we are. We looked at the renewable energy targets vis-a-vis the achievements. Where are we as a whole power sector? The statement is very, very clear. India's power sector is dominated by coal, full stop. Let's look at the graph and understand this a little bit better. Two graphs are there, two donut charts or pie charts. First one is India's power generation by fuel source in installed capacity terms, in gigawatt terms. In the bottom right, you have India energy generation by fuel source in gigawatt hours, so kilowatt hours. So one is power, the other is energy. I'm sure all of you know the difference, so I won't go into that. Let's start with the graph on the left side. If you look at the graph, coal, which includes lignite, forms about 55% of all installed capacity. So if I just total up all the installed capacity, coal forms 55%. But when you look at it in an energy term, right, in kilowatt hour terms, on the bottom right, the same coal becomes 76 or 77%. Okay. Now you may ask why. Why is this? Why is it not a 1:1? Right? And the answer can be found from the green part of the graph on the top left. Renewables form 24% of our installed capacity. Remember, what is our target under Paris? By 2030, we will do 40%. Right? Out of which renewables, which is solar and wind, already form about 25% of our installed capacity. But when you look at on energy terms, let's look on the green part on the bottom right, it only forms about 7%. This is the problem of renewables. That is, 1 megawatt of renewables generates about 1/3 what 1 megawatt of coal generates or gas generates. This is something known as the capacity utilization factor of power plants, or the plant load factor of power plants. Any person working in the generation sector who has some experience will understand this. 1 megawatt of coal is not equal to 1 megawatt of wind or solar. We need 3 megawatt of solar or wind to form 1 megawatt of coal. Coal can run as long as the feedstock is available. It can run 24/7. Solar cannot run 24/7. It can only run as long as the sun is there during the daytime hours. Same way, wind typically tends to be very strong in the night, but not in the daytime. So this is one of the biggest challenges of renewable energy. This is known as intermittency. It's very intermittent. It comes and goes, especially wind, and solar is not available on demand. It's not like Amazon, I can go online, order, and it's dispatched on demand. If I go to solar and say, give me 1 gigawatt hours of solar at 7 p.m. in the night, the power producer will say, sorry, I can't do that. And this is where we need other technologies which can store the energy during the daytime and release the energy during the nighttime. These are known as energy storage technologies. We'll come to that. I'll talk a little bit about this. What is interesting is nuclear forms a very small percentage of India's installed capacity. We have only about 6,700 megawatt of nuclear power plants in India. So although nuclear is carbon free, it's not renewable. Remember what we saw on the first slide. Nuclear is not renewable, but it is certainly carbon free because nuclear is only steam basically. There is no CO2 emissions. So a lot of other countries have said that nuclear is the way to go because we have the technology. It's available 24/7. We have no problem. But there's a huge safety issue with nuclear as well as an attitude of the general public towards nuclear, especially after the Fukushima event that we saw in Japan. Given that Germany, as soon as Fukushima happened, Germany took a decision that we'll shut down all the nuclear power plants. So I think by 2025, Germany will have no nuclear power plants at all. That's a huge announcement. India, meanwhile, we do have strong nuclear program and we are certainly going to accelerate the development of nuclear, but it will never be a mainstream energy source for us. Hydro, on the left side, you can see 12% is coming from hydro. India's, in fact, one of the earliest power plants in India were hydro power plants in the south, in Darjeeling and so on, during the British time. So hydro has traditionally been there, but hydro comes with a lot of challenges. And that is environmental, as you all know. It submerges vast areas of hills, forests. It has a huge biodiversity impact. And also the rain patterns affect hydro dams. In fact, what happened in the Himalayas a few years ago, with all the cloudbursts, etc., the dams being broken, it's mainly because of the fact that we've blocked all the dams. So the natural flow of the water, especially in Himalayas, have been impacted. And a lot of scientists are today saying that this is not the way to go. So large hydro may not certainly be the way to go forward. What is interesting to GAIL employees, I think, is gas. And as you can see, the installed capacity is only 6.6%. So gas is really not, unlike the US, unlike Germany, gas has never been a mainstay production, mainly also because of lack of domestic resources here, but also because of price volatility. In Gujarat, for example, when we installed the combined cycle gas power plant, 375 megawatts, we have two major installations. These gas power plants are running at extremely low PLFs, on an annual basis, less than 10%. So the question is why? One main reason is gas is very expensive. My prices, per unit price for gas is around greater than 5 rupees. Whereas coal is about 2.2 rupees and 2.2 to the new coal plants are about 4.5, and renewable is only about 2 to 2.5 rupees. So gas is nearly 2.5 to 3 times more expensive than renewables, and certainly more expensive than coal. So then the question for us in GAIL also is, what is the future of gas for electricity sector? That is something we need to think about, all of us. How do we ensure domestic gas as well as ensure that there's no price volatility so that the prices can be also brought down? But also, what is the future of gas as a mainstream electricity supply? This is a big question and can be debated, certainly out of scope of this presentation. So that's some food for thought for all of you. And so if you look at the energy basis on the bottom right side, coal remains a dominant energy supplier for India's electricity sector. So next slide shows, but there's a silver lining for this cloud. But India is adding more renewable energy capacity. This graph is from the IEESA, they're a good research organization. If you look from 2012-2013 financial year to about 2021-2022, this financial year, which is an estimate, the gray bar graphs tell you on the y-axis is the installed capacity in megawatt. So, for example, in 2012, we installed about 20 gigawatt of thermal capacity. Very little of renewables, right? The blue-green is very renewable. Look at the change. Since about 2015-16, consequently, we have brought down the installations of coal power plants and ramped up the installation of renewable energy capacity. Very, very positive. And you can see from in line with the national policies, the national targets, the blue part of the graph is solar. So solar will and it's going to remain the mainstay of our electricity supply in this country. And that is very good news. So the conclusion from the last two slides is, while India's, as of today, India's electricity sector is dominated by coal, this is going to change as we go forward in the coming years. Also to fulfill that 450 gigawatt goal by 2030. So your question might be fantastic, but what is driving the capacity of RE? We saw that and I'll start from the bottom, the political will. We saw Mr. Modi's announcement. We saw even before that Mr. Manmohan Singh. There has been a sustained political and policy thrust for renewable energy. So that is very important. Without that, nothing happens. We saw that in America. We are seeing that in Brazil. We're seeing it in other countries where they are anti-renewables, in the Middle East, for example. So political will then translates to policy support, which is the first one. We have the National Solar Mission, which was in 2010. Various states have their own solar missions and their own solar policies. We have wind support programs. Initially, India had the earliest generation-based incentive for wind turbines, various other policies for biomass and so on. So we have very good policy thrust for renewables, more than any other country in this in the world. Then comes the regulatory framework. Yes, we have very good policy, but just like we have the I think it's called the PNRGB for the oil and gas sector. You need a regulatory body that will overview the various rules. We have the Central Electricity Regulatory Commission set up and various state electricity regulatory commissions, which are governing various reverse auction rules, contractual obligations, net metering agreements for rooftop solar. All of these rules are coming up mainly because we have a very good regulatory framework. Very important. And because of clear reverse auctions, just like you have the reverse auctions in the for exploration in the gas sector and in oil sector, you have city gas distribution, very clear guidelines on reverse auctions. Same way for solar and wind capacity, whenever the distribution companies need, you have very clear guidelines. Very important. This is helping investors. Third, cost effectiveness. I've talked about this briefly. Renewable energy today, as on today, as I'm speaking, is cheaper than coal. 2 to 2.5 rupees compared to 4.5 rupees of coal power plants. And this is only the fuel, the variable cost. It does not include the cost for putting up the power plant, the cost for maintenance. That's another 1.5 to 2.5 rupees. So renewable energy is almost half to one third on a per unit basis. So that is fantastic news for especially a country that is trying to electrify so many people under national schemes. We need cheap power in order to help industry, to help people, so on. Investor participation is another very important. A lot of investors are already participating in this country. India has privatized generation, so only the, NTPC may not do the renewables. NTPC can, but also private companies are more than welcome. And we have an automatic route for the FDI, so you don't need any special approvals for that. You have you're a private equity fund outside, you can easily come in and invest in India. So overall, I think we have the necessary pillars for a very good promotion or very good support for renewable energy in India. What is the future going to look like? And this is my last slide. I think I'm also coming to the end of my time, 47 minutes. So what is the future going to look like? We saw that that coal will start to play less and less in importance in the electricity sector, generation sector. Just one announcement last year, if you see from the clipping that I put, both Gujarat, the state where I am from, and this is what we had pushed internally, also Chhattisgarh was the second state, they both announced that they will not build any more coal power plants, right? And this also includes maybe gas power plants, but we have not mentioned that. And that's a bit of a concern. So if you're not going to do any new coal power plants, where will all this energy come from? Obviously, solar and wind. But there is a problem. And that's the second bullet point on the right side. How can renewable energy provide 24/7 electricity on demand? Right? We go back home at, say, come back from office at 7:30 in the summer. We switch on the AC. Suddenly, within seconds, you have a one-ton AC or 1.5-ton AC putting on a demand of about 1 kilowatt onto the grid. You have not told anybody that I'm going to put on the AC. No kind of signaling goes, but then still the grid supplies to you, right? That's because of the flexibility that gas and coal can give us. Renewables cannot give this, right? So how can the existing gas-fired power plants, for example, this is what I believe gas will be very critical. It can quickly ramp up and ramp down, right? The ramp rates of gas power plants are very, very fast, unlike coal. So how can gas not compete with renewable energy, but complement renewable energy? That is going to be the future. So if we had to provide renewable energy 24/7 on demand, obviously somebody tells you, sorry, we don't have enough solar at 7 p.m. in the evening, we can't supply energy to you. You will say, my God, this is not okay. You will call the electricity company in Delhi, BSES, or whichever that is, and say, no, this is not acceptable. Right? So we cannot assume such a situation. We need on-demand electricity, and gas, I believe, has a role. Maybe a limited role, but a very critical role. Third point is energy storage devices, batteries, lithium-ion batteries that you see in your phones, in your laptops, in your Bluetooth speakers. When you just imagine it in a bigger scale, you see it in cars, Tata Nexon, EV, you might be knowing this. Of course, Tesla, we all know that. On a much bigger scale, you see Tesla installing a battery for Australia, for Hawaii. In India, the first installation is in Delhi. Those of you who are interested, you can go and see this. In the BSES Rajdhani Power, they've installed a lithium-ion-based battery backup. And so these energy storage devices start playing greater role. We will soon replace all the coal fire and the oil fired power plants in Andaman and Nicobar Islands with solar plus storage. This will be the first islands, I think, in India for sure, and definitely maybe one among the first in the world to go fully renewables. So we're looking forward to very exciting developments in this sector. Pumped hydro. What is pumped hydro? When you have energy, you pump up, run pumps, put it up onto the reservoir, and when you need the energy, you open up the gates and then you run the turbines. So this kind of a pumped hydro will also be critical. Again, location is a problem. We can't do it in Rajasthan. We have to do it in where it's available, in the Himalayas, in the northeast, in some areas in South India, in the Western Ghats. Only where the location is there, we can do pumped hydro. Finally, I'd like to end here and sort of give some food for thought to all of you. Can we actually look at 100% renewable electricity? So that entire electricity generation sector, 51% of emissions, can we actually eliminate this? This is the big question which researchers like me are trying to answer. There are no easy answers. It's not going to be an easy path because we have existing coal capacities. We have many challenges of renewable energy. But I believe that we can be optimistic, that we can indeed move towards 100% renewable electricity. It cannot happen today. It may not happen tomorrow. But certainly in the next 10, 15, 20 years, we may be able to finally say, yes, India has successfully decarbonized its electricity sector. And so I think with that hopeful note, I would like to end my presentation and hand it back to the distinguished members of GAIL. Thank you very much again for giving me the opportunity, and I wish you a very, very warm day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing such a nice knowledge with us. And now I will request Sri P.C. Gupta, Chief Manager, TQM, to give vote of thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adhav. On behalf of Corporate TQM Department, it's my pleasure to extend vote of thanks on today's program, Role of Renewable Energy in India's Electricity Sector. I would like to express my gratitude and respect to distinguished guest speaker Sri Akhilesh Magal, Head Renewable Energy Advisory Board, Gujarat Energy Research and Management Institute, for sparing his valuable time for us to deliver the talks on the topic, which is very much relevant on Saksham 2021 theme for clean and green energy. We are very much thankful to Sri Akhilesh for enlightening us with the knowledge, experience, and policy in the field of renewable energy sector and its importance. I wish to express my gratitude to team GTI Noida BIs to organize this program in Sachem 2020-21 for mass awareness campaigning. I also wish to thanks everyone who involved directly and indirectly to organize this program. My heartfelt thanks to all GAIL employees who joined this program through webcast from various sites across GAIL. Thank you very much to all. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.